Hi, and welcome to my session on caffeine and code and money. I am Elisa, and I started with web and print design in 2000, and I started with Joomla in 2006. In 2008, I made marketing studies and got self-employed in 2009. And in 2014, I was co-founder of something I will tell you now about. I had a customer that was a coffee roaster. And to be able to do good marketing for this coffee roaster, I had to learn a lot about the product itself. And I always loved coffee. But knowing more about coffee, I loved it even more. And this customer, he sold also white label coffee. I come from Nürnberg, and Nürnberg is famous for its Christkindlesmarkt. And me and my colleague, we achieved to get a booth at this Christkindlesmarkt for our customer and to sell coffee there. And we didn't want to miss the opportunity to be one day also there and be a barista and work at this booth. It was a really great experience. And a lot of people passed by, and we had also a roaster at the booth, and we could show the people everything about coffee, and it was really, really much fun. And when we spent the day there at the Christmas market, we had an idea. We will get rich. Okay, I'm kidding by saying we will get rich. But it was the intention to earn some money by building up our own coffee brand. We were a perfect marketing and design team, and so we had no budget to spend in these areas and no customer to tell us how to do our stuff. And the statistics, they were good. In Germany, the average person drinks 6.65 kilo coffee per year. So there's definitely a market for it. And is here someone from the Netherlands? So you're awake. You're on place number 2 in the EU with 9.55 kilo of coffee per year. But we discussed how to stand out of the crowd. Just another coffee brand. How can we make a difference on the market? And we found out that every roaster has a coffee brand, also a caffeine-free version of the coffee brand. But it's more a side product. It has not a lot of attention. It's just, let's do one coffee also for those people that don't drink caffeine. There's not much emotion in it, not much hard. And due to statistics, there are 4.49 million people in Germany that drink caffeine-free coffee. And even more, we could reach with our communication. Not only old people, also people that have intolerances or, for example, autoimmune disorders. Pregnant women. Due to statistics, women that drink a lot of caffeine in the pregnancy, the children have a lower birth weight. Or business people. Imagine guys that drink 20 coffees per day just to accompany their clients. They could drink caffeine-free coffee too. Sportive people, and so on. But how does one decaf coffee? Do you know that? So the bean gets steamed with water and then it's bathed in the compressed CO2, and then the caffeine is filtered out of the bean and extracted. And the caffeine is used then for example medication or energy drinks. It's recycled. And that was the speciality about our coffee, because it was naturally decaffeinated with CO2. But there are also other ways to decaf coffee in a chemical way with solvents. And one of the solvents is, for example, the trichloroethylene. And this is a solvent that is on the list of probable cause of cancer. And if there are also other decaf processes with other solvents, but you should know that the solvent could remain in the bean, at least a bit of it, and the future health risk of it is not foreseeable. So this was something that might made our coffee special. It was naturally decaffeinated. And there's one more thing that made the coffee special. It was a fair decaffeinated coffee. What is fair coffee? Do you know that? Alex?
Yeah, I think for all the people who invited in the process should be getting enough money for the work. A fair balance from the very beginning till the end could produce a more or less.
Yeah, so you say fair coffee is when everyone with the coffee chain gets enough money to live from.
Yeah.
Basically. Yeah. But most of you will think maybe that the fair trade certificate is a guarantee for this. But I have to tell you it's not. Because a fair trade certificate, it costs a lot of money. And that's obvious that a poor grower cannot afford the certificate. And there are also studies from Harvard that there is no positive impact on coffee laborers, no positive impact on the children's education of the laborers, and there's even a negative impact on the education of children of unskilled coffee workers. And the studies show also that the long-term benefit from fair trade certificate is essentially zero. One more thing is that the fair trade certificate indeed guarantees us a price for the bean, for the raw beans. But some coffee growers tend to push the low quality beans into this channel because of fear getting stuck with it. So it's also not a guarantee for quality. And the one last thing is that the transfer of your goodwill is also not effective in the fair trade certificate. Our roaster was member of the association Deutsche Röstergilde. There are many more associations like that. And this association takes care of really fair trade, of a high quality of the beans, freshness, transparency, and also of traditional roasting. Since I was talking about the growers, do you know how coffee was discovered? Anyone?
By accident, if I recall correctly.
So, the story I heard about is that there was a goat herder, and he discovered this that his goats got very energetic and couldn't sleep at night after eating those fruits from a plant. And he reported these findings to the abbot of the monastery, and the monks collected those fruits and wanted to eat them, but they were very sour and bitter and really not eatable, and they threw it into the fire. And when they threw the coffee cherries into the fire, a really good smell came up, and they thought, smells nice, let's take this roasted beans and make a drink of it. And then they found out that this drink kept them awake through the night prayers. And this story is not proved. This story has a lot of variations, but it sounds quite nice. So the coffee is growing at such a plant, and these are the coffee cherries, and inside of the cherry there are two beans facing each other. And that's how raw coffee beans look like. I have something with me. 2 sacks of raw coffee beans. I would ask you to take some beans out of every bag and give it to the next one. I have there enough inside. Just take some out and give it to the next one.
I can open it.
Of both bags, please. Of different, of each. Yeah. Good.
Do you want it or decaf?
But not decaf ones. But better raw coffee beans. I want you to look at the coffee beans. Actually, not either. I have some roasted here too. Wait a bit. Yes. Okay, so if you look at the coffee beans, they have a difference. And there are many sorts of coffee beans, but the main sorts are Arabica beans and Robusta beans. You can recognize the Arabica bean because it has an S shape on the bean, and it's bigger than the Robusta bean. The Robusta bean is smaller and circular with a straight line on it. The Arabica bean grows in higher altitudes and the Robusta bean in lower altitudes. Thank you. Sorry. The speciality about Arabica bean is that it has a double pair of chromosomes than the Robusta bean, and therefore it has way more flavors than the Robusta bean. It has a soft and fruity taste, and and the double of sugar inside than the Robusta bean. While the Robusta bean tastes more grainy, peanutty, more harsh, and the Robusta bean grows in lower altitudes, and therefore it needs a natural defense against bugs. And the natural defense against bugs is the double amount of caffeine. It sounds like the perfect developer bean, doesn't it? And some of you might think that maybe the Arabica bean, because it's in commercials, they mention it, it's an Arabica bean, has more quality, but that's not always the case. So both beans can be equal in the quality. But the Robusta is easier to grow and is higher, so it's also cheaper. And How does the coffee harvest look like? There are two kinds of coffee harvesting. The one is picking, and with picking, the grower picks only the ripe fruits from the trees, from the plants, and the other one stays at the tree, the unripe ones, and the overripe ones are thrown away. And with stripping, they put off all the cherries from the tree with a machine or with a tool, and then it's sorted out mechanical. But it's a higher danger that with the stripping method, the overripe beans or unripe beans are mixed up in one delivery. So it's better, the picking method has a better quality. I mentioned before that we had this certificate of the Deutsche Rösterbilde, and they take care also of traditional roasting. And there's a huge difference between traditional roasting and mass production. I will tell you now three big facts about the difference between those two. But there are many more reasons why traditional roasting is better than mass production. The first thing is the amount. In traditional roasting, you have around 15 kilograms of coffee per roasting process. And in mass production, you have several tons of coffee in one roasting process. And it's nearly impossible to control or even roasting in mass production compared to traditional roasting. The second thing is the temperature and the duration. In traditional roasting, it's about 15 to 20 minutes at 200 degrees. And when you look at the coffee bean you have in your hand, you compare it to those, you can just get it further. It has the double size of the bean. And in between this 15 to 20 minutes, the coffee bean takes up double of the volume, and it cracks also like popcorn. And during this time, the coffee bean loses chlorogenic acids and bitterness, and the flavors are unfolding during the roasting process. In mass production, when I mentioned several tons of coffee and they are put in the machine for 2 minutes at 500 to 800 degrees. So it's really fast and hot, and during these 2 minutes the acids cannot escape properly and the bitterness stays inside, and some beans get maybe also burned and stay raw inside. And that's a really problem. And one more thing is the cooling. In traditional roasting, the beans come out of the drum roaster in such a sieve and are cooled by air. And in mass production, they cool it down with water. Do you know what happens too when you cool down the beans with water?
Make coffee.
Almost.
Maybe they break.
The beans get soaked with the water.
Yeah.
That's a win situation for the industry, because they can sell it at a higher weight. It's allowed to have, I think it's around 20% more weight in the bean, because of the water inside at selling. So if you buy coffee for mass production, you buy water too. So in conclusion, traditional roasting is more even, and therefore it's better digestive. It's handmade. It's really a person taking care of the actual weather condition and everything, and controlling with the ice. Is the coffee like I want it to be, another machine? You have a higher unfolding of the flavors, less acid, and it's more stomach friendly. Some people think that they are generally intolerant against caffeine because they have maybe heartburn or stomach pain, but that's not always the case. It could be also just industrial produced coffee that is uneven, partly raw inside, or has many bitter substances, high acid content, like I said, higher weight of the beans, and irritates the stomach. And this bad taste is sometimes hidden, or often hidden. I brought you a label. It's unfortunately German, but maybe you can see it's 89% of coffee beans inside, and the rest is sugar. Sugar is good to hide the bad taste. And maybe, yeah?
The best way to drink coffee is without milk, without sugar.
Yes. Yeah. But here the sugar is added just to hide the taste. But you're right. And Sarah, you wouldn't like it now. Starbucks, maybe you saw it in the news or you heard it in the news, but they have to carry a cancer warning in California. The reason for that is that the Starbucks coffee is of course also from mass production, and it contains way more acrylamide than traditional roasted coffee. And acrylamide is also a probable cause of cancer. Yeah. Back to the story of the founding thing. We wanted to make a cool and fair traditional roasted caffeine-free coffee. And we managed to find a name within a budget of several liters of coffee. And so Roaster was born. And we had different communication things, like postcards towards our target audience, like to the pregnant women. We said, and it's saying, don't go without, also not with delicious coffee. Drink coffee from morning to the evening. For the cool grannies, the best bean is the one without. It's word game in German, not translatable. And we put a lot of passion into the packaging. I have to smile when I think about it, because we had this white coffee bags. We spread it on the table, and we had a stamp with our logo, and we stamped every bag separately with the hand. And then we put the brown label around the bag and wrote the origin of the coffee on the bag, because we had several origins. We put in, we wrote on the amount by hand. Then we had small stickers saying it has a bio certificate. Some coffees had one, so we put this label on some, and some not, and so on. And then we had another postcards saying something about coffee, and people loved the postcards because we didn't push our products into their face. We told them on the postcards how to brew coffee correctly, or how everything I told you, what is the difference between industrial production and mass production. The only thing was the logo and the domain on the cards. And the people loved it. Or for example, a recipe for coffee pear cake. And people start sending us pictures of the cake they made with the coffee. And we had also to create an online shop for that. And I'm a bit ashamed, but we took a theme for a theme. With Virtual Mart store. But after after we sold some coffees, I coded my own template, and of course, virtual mud was gone very fast. And I have to be honest, sometime later, we dropped also to have this shop in Joomla itself, because the German law was, even before the GDPR, very strict in e-commerce and was not easy to comply to the law. And there's a very good e-commerce system called Shopware, and we used it to build, to rebuild everything, and it's definitely worth a look. I have a lot of Joomla web stores running with J2 store, I can recommend that too. But if you have e-commerce in your focus, then it's way easier with Shopware to automate everything and to comply to laws and printing out the delivery labels and so on. And what did we want to do else? We wanted to have a lot of fans, of course. And I was creating Facebook fan pages for customers, but I never offered social media as a service because I had no experience with it. But with Roaster, I had to gain some experience. And I bought one of the 10 euro courses from Udemy. The title was a step-by-step guide to your first 1,000 Facebook fans. And I thought, okay, spending 10 euro will not hurt me. Let's see what if it will help. And we got 1,200 likes in 3 weeks with all the strategies I followed from this workshop. And Facebook was also a very good tool for spreading the word to the target audience, because you have all this filtering where who you want to show your advertising to. And after this huge success with the 1,200 likes, also a blogger came to us and asked us for an interview. And we also got attention from the local newspaper, and they made an interview with us, and then the business started to grow. And one thing I'm really proud of is also that we were ranked on place one on Google with caffeine-free coffee. And it's almost the same like with Facebook. I didn't do very much SEO before. I just did the basic stuff that everyone recommends. But a lot of customers didn't have the budget to spend so much money on SEO. But for my own baby, I spent as much time as possible. And one thing was that we spent a lot of time on the technical details. You know, a lot of those SEO analysis tools that say alt attribute is missing, title is missing, the script is too big, this image is too big, and everything. We really keep care of every single detail. We had, in every tool, we had 100%. And the second thing was the content. We had a blog, and we wrote a lot about coffee and how to make coffee, like on the cards. And what also was a helper was Google Suggest. That's when you type in something in the search bar and Google suggests you some search terms. I played around with it very much, and then I found out that pregnant women search for caffeine-free coffee, but with a specific abbreviation. It's German. The week of the pregnancy is Schwangerschaftswoche, and they didn't wrote Schwangerschaftswoche, but SSW. And there were two specific weeks where women were very interested about if they can drink coffee or not. And they wrote SSW 26 or SSW 32 and so on. And we put in those keywords and those topics also on the website, and wrote about coffee and pregnancy and what to care about, how much can you drink, is it dangerous or is it just better and so on. So this was a good deliverer for ideas for content. And with all of the strategies, we sold really a lot of coffee. But we didn't earn any money. We found out that the personal and good communication with our customers was really worth the gold, and that the passion we put inside the product, the stamping with the hand and writing down everything, and we had have to skip back to the packages. We had those white delivery boxes with a brown label, and the label said that's a package for a wonderful person. And we tried to put emotion on everything what we did. But we had really small earnings on each package, and all the work we did and all the time we spent, we couldn't cover the cost that we had. The accounting, the server costs, whatever. And we also had to pay for the delivery the same like every person would do. We had no discounts from the shipping companies. And I said in the beginning that we planned to get rich, but that was not really the intent, because in fact we wanted to be independent of our customers. We wanted to do our own thing and to put passion in something. And I learned a lot doing this. I learned the social media stuff. I learned how to do good SEO. And the only solution that would bring us forward in the end would be to have our own coffee roasting machine and roast ourselves, which would mean to have a high invest on this roaster. Or the second possibility would have been to have a coffee bar and sell coffee there, because you earn a lot of money when you sell coffee live, or both together, of course. Or drop that, and your own, or a lot of people here know me. My heart is Joomla. I love doing web design. I don't want to be a waiter in a coffee bar or be a roaster. And we decided to sell roaster to a roaster. And he's a roastery from Franconia. And I'm very happy that Roaster is still successful and is still there, and that he's putting his heart and soul in it. And my conclusion of the whole thing is that with Joomla we are able to build up our dreams and to create something. And even if you don't earn any money on it, I would recommend everyone to have our own project, something that interests you, and leave your comfort zone and learn something. And if you really don't have an idea what to do, you could join a Joomla team, you could join the marketing team, social media team, and learn something there, because it's not always about to earn, it's also about to learn. So I look if you have maybe any questions.
Ich glaube, wir würden alle gern klatschen, aber
Kaffee in den Händen. Kaffee in den Händen.
Coffee break.
Ja, Coffee break. Can you have coffee break then?
Four. Okay, there in Slido there are no questions. Do you have any questions about coffee?
Towards me.
Yeah.
So your brand is still going on, but sold in another company, right?
Yes.
What I'm very interested in health things, mm-hmm. and I like coffee much. And what kind of coffee would you recommend when I say I like to have a healthy coffee without any pesticides, ecologically correct, and also fair trade? Is that all in that?
I can recommend you basically every coffee that has, for example, this Deutsche Röstergilde sign on it. It's very good. I don't know about the international certificates, but to look for direct trade coffee, that would be very good.
Direct trade coffee.
Yeah. And there's a difference between the very dark roasted coffee. It has less flavors than the light roasted coffee. And the dark roasted coffee is more for espresso, and the light roasted coffee has a little bit more essence. But also taste more flavors in it. I didn't want to say that caffeine-free coffee is a more healthier one. It really depends on the person.
Yeah.
Because caffeine has also very great healthy aspects. But that was a niche where we went into to just stand out of the crowd. Any other questions? You had one in the beginning, I think.
I can't remember now. So
it was about the most expensive coffee.
Well, what do you drink Roadstar yourself?
I drank Roadstar, yes. But okay, I have not big issues with
caffeine.
With caffeine, I can drink a lot of it. I was drinking it from time to time, of course, for quality reasons.
Quality control.
And also because I have also an autoimmune disorder, and I checked if it helps me or not, but I have generally not much issues with it, so it was okay.
I wasn't here the first few minutes, but when did you start the project? I mean, how long did it take?
The idea was in 2013, and we started right away. I think in March 2014 we had our first coffee sold. We set up the shop very fast, as I told. We put more focus on the design and the communication than in the coding in the beginning. But then I saw that it's really important. But for the first start, it was great. Didn't cost a lot of money and a lot of time. And the people that visited our shop, didn't matter if it was a virtual mat store or something else. But later for SEO and such stuff, it was really important to have a good technical basis.
Which mistake, if you did make any mistakes, did you learn the most from?
I wouldn't name it a mistake, but of course our calculation was absolutely wrong. But we didn't look for the money because it was really a passionate project, and we didn't count on how many hours we spent on which communication part or marketing, optimization, whatever. If it would be a serious business, you should really know your numbers and maybe have even a business angel that invests in the beginning to set everything up. But it wasn't about that, so I wouldn't name it a mistake. And one thing I saw that didn't work absolutely was to give the coffee away as a like a sample to friends. A lot of friends came around and said, "Ah, you serve caffeine-free coffee now. I cannot drink caffeine. I need this coffee. Okay, here's one pack." And in my mind, I had, "Okay, I sell one. I give one pack away, and he will buy at least two." But that didn't happen very often. But we had a lot of customers that were really fans and bought the coffee over and over again.
I have a question about quality, money, and culture, because I'm not into coffee. Coffee is coffee for me. But last month I was on a holiday. I started in Italy. I learned to drink espresso.
Mm-hmm.
It was about oil, and I like it very much. Then I moved to our mission. The coffee was about 3 euro.
Mm-hmm.
It was good, but not the same. I tasted the taste wasn't the same.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure which one was better. For me, this from Italy, maybe because it was from the beginning. I started there. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
So I replaced coffee with beer.
It's a good possibility. Yeah.
Yeah,
we will do it later too.
Yeah, it's very very good. Then I came back to Poland.
Mm-hmm.
So at the very beginning, I go to a coffee shop. I bought espresso. It was okay. Yeah. Then I because now in Poland there's a hype on a lot of crafts beer.
Mm-hmm.
So you can choose from not 3-4 but from 20 crafts.
Krakow
in Warsaw. Yeah. And I came home relaxed. Yeah. But then I realized that from the very beginning, when I started my holiday, I started drinking coffee, then beer, and now I'm not sure which is better in my memories. But I'm still thinking why this espresso for 1 euro
mm-hmm.
was so good. Yeah.
Because from what I know,
Italian. Yeah,
from what I know, the Italian coffee is much darker roasted than the coffee in Germany. So maybe you like dark roasted coffee better. And when you watch out for coffee beans, then look for a dark roast coffee.
I was thinking about it, but in Italy, nobody asked me what kind of coffee.
Yeah, because it's generally
When I ask about coffee,
mm-hmm.
it means espresso.
Yeah.
When I there will be cappuccino, okay, but
mm-hmm.
When I ask about latte,
mm-hmm.
they give me a glass of milk.
Yes. Latte is a glass of milk there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in Germany you have espresso beans that are the dark roasted, or you have coffee. And coffee is the light roasted coffee. And coffee has even more flavors than wine has. And it's very interesting. There's this coffee wheel, and when someone is doing a coffee tasting, you describe how the coffee tastes, like peanutty or more like lemon fruits or something. That was very interesting. Back then, when we had Roaster, we went also to events like J and Beyond, but it was Coffee and Beyond. And we did this coffee tasting, and we were involved in the process, which raw beans to buy for our coffee and so on. It was very interesting. Mm-hmm.
How long can you keep coffee beans that are, what do you say?
When it's
roasted,
yeah, when it's sealed, I think it's like a half year to 1 year. But when you open it, you should use it in between 4 to 6 weeks. But don't keep it in the fridge. That's a myth to keep it in the fridge. Just dark and good sealed. And maybe not too warm, but in the fridge there's too much moist. And gets inside the bag, and when the beans get soaked with the moist, and that's not good. Has any one of you an online shop?
Yeah.
Sorry. Alex?
Yeah, with some CDs for animal moving maker, adventure stories. Just 3 products, but
yeah.
It's going on and on and on since 4 years now.
And it's our own project from you?
Yes, my client, and
mm-hmm.
I produced this series. with another guy and a movie maker. And the movie maker in Germany is very famous, so everybody knows him. Who's a fan of natural or animal movies. And so we have the idea to put this thing animal movie for audio. And we thought about, could this be functionary? Because the movie is living from the pictures and the big animals. But this guy has the talent to tell stories very intensively and very spannend, exciting, yeah. And it, yeah, some CDs in a week we sell 2 or 3 CDs. It's not much, but it's a little bit going on and on.
Yeah. It's great, yeah.
It's also Shopware.
Yeah. Yeah, Shopware is a great system. Yeah.
We, except for selling Joomla extensions, we also sell web development or web trainings. So it's more like, how do you rock social media, or how do you use Infusionsoft, or here's how you can get started in how to craft your customer journey or avatar. That's really a good way of actually also extending your
knowledge.
Business.
Yeah, and that's online. Very good if you just have a specific project that where you are not limited with budget. Just do your own thing. As I said, your own idea, or join a Joomla team, and then maybe join a training from PrixPro and learn what you need to do for this, to put it into a success. It was really fun. I don't regret anything.
Thank you so much for sharing.
Yeah,
for
sharing.
Thanks.
Thank you.